A lot of people believe that art had no social value because it was produced by strange people who were artists. Artists had a bad reputation too. They were all intellectuals.
The visual arts abound in Oregon these days. Painters comprise the largest single sector, and their work shows a remarkable range of styles and influences. Hundreds of galleries, at least 80 in Portland alone, display and sell Oregon art, and each year, millions of art-related dollars flow through the state economy. Yet not so long ago, the Oregon art scene and the opportunities available to artists were very different, more limited in many ways.
Being an artist was a problem, a big problem, because you were a foreigner to the community. And having no money, it was a very important problem. In that way, you were more or less removed from the community.
Mike Russo taught at the Portland Art Museum School. Portland was the arts capital of Oregon, and most of the city's artists were in some way linked to the school.
It was a real scene. It was small. It was not wealthy, but it was a scene. Everybody looked at each other's work. Everybody talked about each other's work.
But nobody sold much work. Portland had no successful art galleries.
There were some restaurants near the art museum, and we would arrange with the proprietor to put paintings up, usually a one-man show in the restaurant. Very big deal in those days.
Nobody ever expected to make it big, because there was no big to make.
Back then, modern art in a public place could cause quite a stir.
When that mural went up, there was a lot of grief. I mean, people thought he was a communist. They thought it was some kind of plot. It's hard to imagine why people would have been so angry, but they were really angry.
This man, perhaps the most influential painter in Oregon history, lived quietly and modestly in downtown Portland.
So he was carrying on for, you know, his whole life without an income from art to speak of. Finally was living on Social Security and painting. It's a very odd thing to be in a profession that had no possibility in those days of making a living from it. Can you imagine that?
Yet all that time, and dating back to the 1800s, a succession of Oregon artists kept making art. Teachers taught it. Others introduced the community to it.
So it was gradually building a constituency that had an appreciation for art. One thing builds on another until you have a community of interested people in Portland that's very, very large.
We had a purpose in just developing modern art. What has happened is that modern art is generally accepted all over.
Funding for Oregon Experience is provided by the James F. and Marion L. Miller Foundation, the Ann and Bill Swindells Charitable Trust, the Oregon Cultural Trust, and from viewers like you. Thank you.
The very first artists in what is now Oregon were Native people. Their designs and embellishments evolved through countless generations. Each tribal group imparted a distinctive, identifiable style to its artwork, and so it was for centuries. In time, the new settlers came. They brought their own aesthetic sensibilities, influenced by other people and places far away. Never again would the art of this region be easy to characterize, because Oregon had become, and continues to be, a land of settlers.
There is a traditional foundation to Oregon painting that is late 19th century and early 20th century landscape painting. Quite realistic, quite celebratory of the beauties of the region. A good amount of it was so-called plein air painting. Artists would go out into nature. It was realistic, direct painting of what they saw.
But at the end of the 19th century, Oregon had few public venues to display these or any other paintings. Only by traveling elsewhere could Oregonians keep in touch with the world of art. Several prominent Portlanders set out to change that, and in 1895 they created the Portland Art Museum.
It was Portlanders who had been to Europe and had studied art in Europe and came back to Portland with a lot of notions about contemporary art and wanted to introduce it to Portland, and they did.
Originally, the museum was on the second floor of the Portland Library. And for its first couple of years, the art museum had no art, only books about art. Its first acquisition was a collection of plaster replicas of Greek and Roman statues. The museum hosted various exhibits, sometimes black and white photographs of important paintings. But not until 1908 would it purchase a painting of its own, Afternoon Sky, Harney Desert, by Child Hassam. In 1905, the Lewis and Clark Exposition came to town. It featured a world-class exhibit of European and American artists and exposed crowds of Oregonians to some of the finest art of the time. The Portland Art Museum School opened in the new museum building in 1909. The principal, Annabelle Crocker, had helped found the museum and continued to serve as its curator. In 1910, she hired a young artist named Harry Wentz, recently returned from studies in New York.
Very influential teacher, taught generations and decades of students. He's really the one who pioneered the idea that artists in Oregon should respond to their region, but should do so in personal, expressive terms, where you might well use arbitrary color, broad, flat planes, typically depicting something, but in modern terms. So I would say Oregon modernism starts with him, and if it starts with him, it starts in 1910. If Harry Wentz is the pioneer of modernism in the state, another major figure in launching it, it was C.S. Price, Clayton Sumner Price.
Price grew up in a large ranching family in Iowa and Wyoming.
His early career in art was as an illustrator for Western magazines, rearing horses and stagecoaches that are about to go off cliffs, and very beautiful drawings, but very, very illustrational.
Then, in 1915, he traveled to San Francisco for a show of contemporary art. The paintings he saw transformed his artistic vision.
It's just like, boom, he got it. He saw all this modernistic, early modern European stuff like Cézanne and all that, and he just, it sort of ignited something in him. And then he came back home and started making these really completely forward-looking paintings.
The body becomes trunk-like, the head is an oval, this figure is simplified. The details of identity and specificity of anatomy are generalized and disappear. C.S. Price was the major figure in the pre-war period who brought European modernism, the idea of Cubism and the School of Paris, to Portland.
He came to Portland in 1929 as an established artist. Had a show at the Myron Frank department store, which had a gallery in those days, and everyone was swept off their feet by this work, which was very much expressionist modern painting, quite different from anything most Portlanders had seen. And he rapidly became a kind of ideal for some of the younger artists.
I was a scholarship student at the Museum Art School in '31. We made pilgrimages, I might say, to his studio. Many of us would try to ask him to give lessons. He resolutely refused to do that. He was a very, very modest, selfless man.
Price also inspired a young painter named Charles Haney.
If you look closely at this work, it demonstrates Haney's beautiful painting skills. It's very textured. The paint builds up into crusts and little peaks that suggest the terrain on the one hand, but very much suggests that it's paint on the other.
C.S. Price often painted from small models he had carved from wood or fashioned from paper. Charles Haney adopted the model technique, too.
Haney would travel out through Oregon, eastern Oregon, down into Nevada during the summers, making sketches, going through all these little mining towns and other rural hamlets. But he wouldn't paint on these trips. He'd come back to his Portland studio, his little house. Then he would take these little constructions, which he used over and over and over again, and he'd set them up. So in a way, his villages are essentially still life paintings, filtered through memory and prompted by drawings.
The lives of artists were never easy, and the Great Depression hit them especially hard. But the Works Progress Administration and other federal programs sponsored public art projects and put many artists back to work. Louis Bunce painted this large mural for the Grants Pass Post Office.
With the WPA, artists were reflecting the local scene. They were looking for storytelling opportunities in paint, prints, sculpture.
It was a scene that was dominated by imagery, narrative, traditional forms of realism and semi-abstracted realism.
The WPA artist case that I know best is the Charles Haney story. He did a whole series of prints for the WPA. He did about 70 paintings. He recalled it virtually saved his life. He had gone to work as a ditch digger. He was totally poverty-stricken. Suddenly, this art project came on, and it saved him.
WPA workers built Timberline Lodge, and artists adorned the inside.
One of Charles Haney's masterpieces is that big painting of Mount Hood that hangs in Timberline Lodge. C.S. Price was commissioned to do murals for Timberline, and so were numerous other artists.
Doug Lynch was hired to design a Timberline mural called Calendar of Mountain Sports. From these early sketches, he carved and painted a room of wall-sized panels.
I was thinking that it would be simple-minded kind of stuff. It turned out to be acres and acres and acres and acres of linoleum.
All kinds of people who later became famous and did very well as artists were maintained by their working for the WPA. So that had a huge impact on arts after that period.
Only a few of Oregon's better-known artists were women.
Amanda Snyder was a good friend of Charles Haney and C.S. Price. Something of a stay-at-home person. She was quite shy, rarely went to her own openings of exhibitions and so forth.
Martina Gangel, her husband kind of talked her out of being an artist when she was one of the best local artists of the time.
Today, many of Oregon's best-known artists are women. But that trend would not begin until long after the end of World War II.
The period right after the war saw the arts in Oregon energized as never before.
World War II set up the GI Bill, and so you had huge numbers of men coming back from service who had funding available to pursue a dream, to follow directions they might not have followed had they stayed on the farm in Bend or out in Bandon fishing.
So that's why when you say Oregon art, now you're talking about a huge influx of people from all over.
We suddenly had a bunch of art students in the museum, and those guys were mature. Many of them had been soldiers, and they knew they wanted to be artists.
The museum art school employed several former students to teach the swelling classes. Before the war, many local artists had traveled to New York to enhance their studies. That East Coast connection continued.
We were very aware of New York and making trips there and always looking at the art magazines to see what was going on and so on. We were physically isolated from New York, but very much in the swim of the ideas that were going on in contemporary art.
The school hired a new teacher from Connecticut, Mike Russo.
We were very much Easterners and had no concept of what the West was about. We came out here and it was a real adventure.
Mike Russo was the husband of noted artist Sally Haley, the exquisite still life painter. And they were quite the couple on the Portland scene for years and years and years. He's very much a figurative painter, and a human figure, flattened and abstracted and simplified.
The fine arts were not restricted to Portland.
This is a painting by Carl Hall. Carl Hall discovered Oregon in 1942 when he was drafted and came out to do basic training at Camp Adair, fell in love with Oregon, and after serving in the Pacific, he came back and settled in Salem. And this is actually a scene that you still can visit in Salem. It's the slough out on Minto Island, which is a park south of downtown.
Brothers Albert and Arthur Rundquist left Portland to live and paint on the coast. But Portland remained the center of serious art in Oregon. Portland artists Carl and Hilda Morris were selling much of their work, mostly to East Coast and Bay Area buyers. But in this regard, they were still rare exceptions.
Even people like Louis Bunce and Mike Russo, who you know are big names now, they weren't selling anything in those days. They would have a show and not sell a thing, or maybe one painting or something. There was no possibility of selling art or of making a living at it. At the same time, there was just complete seriousness and dedication about the art itself. And all of us who were eventually teachers, which I was, spent still at least a 40-hour week painting as well as teaching. The art community also was relatively small. We'd get together for parties, and in a sense, every artist in town would be there. It was a very lively time with lots of discussion about painting and some dancing and drinking, and it got very contentious too around the abstract expressionist years. People were really into it. Abstract expressionism became something that was so all-pervasive that it was like it choked out everything else.
In the 50s, there was a big division between the art school artists and the traditional artists. And that stirred up a lot of resentment because the Oregon Artists Society thought, well, they're getting pushed out, that they're the real artists, and here are all these people just throwing paint on the canvas. They're getting the attention.
In time, the public clash between the old and new values would die down, but not before 1958, when the city of Portland commissioned a large mural for the airport.
Louis Bunce was an Oregon painter of great renown and significance. Bunce had a tremendous range, from surrealist figurative paintings in the 30s to highly abstract non-representational works, highly controversial Portland Airport murals, which I guess most publicly of all events we could think of brought modernism right into the face of the Portland public, and there was some discomfort to say the least over that.
If you study the history of artists, like Van Gogh, Van Gogh looks all right today, but when he did his paintings, people revolted against it.
When that mural went up, there was a lot of grief. I mean, people put dead possums on his lawn. They called him up and threatened him with death threats. They were angry.
In the end, Portland people came to terms with the painting.
It kind of put contemporary art on the map in terms of public thinking at that time. So the public was, that was a big deal in making the public aware that there was some art going on here, and it wasn't just paintings of Mount Hood. Louis became just a huge celebrity. He was somewhat known by that time in Portland, but he became a household name.
Our sponsor takes great pride in presenting the nationally famed artist Louis Bunce as your host on a new concept in television programming.
New art programs at colleges and universities around the state were teaching a new generation of artists. In 1961, Jack and Barbara McLarty opened the Image Gallery in Portland. To the public, art was beginning to seem less foreign, more familiar.
A lot of these people began to get the notion that art was interesting and that it was also difficult to do.
Arlene Schnitzer's interest in art had started years earlier with an art history class from Mike Russo. In 1961, this well-to-do and well-connected Portland native opened a commercial gallery, The Fountain. She persuaded people to collect art. She encouraged corporations to buy art for their offices. She sold the work of Northwest artists, lots of it.
Arlene had a very big role to play, I think, opening the Fountain Gallery and bringing many people to the gallery to buy, convincing them that art was a valuable thing to have in their lives.
I sold to school teachers who paid me $5 a month, and I sold to corporations, and I sold to people that came down from the hill. Anybody, I used to say, I don't care why they buy. If they think it's to keep up with the Joneses or to match the couch or because they think it's the thing to do, I don't care. I just want to get that painting in their house. Because once it's in their house, try to take it away. Their life is changed forever.
And after the Fountain Gallery, then there came more and more galleries. Now, of course, there are a lot of them.
Oregon has never ranked high in financial support for the arts, and today it languishes behind nearly every other state. Yet something about this place continues to nurture the making of art.
Artists have been coming to the state for over 150 years. They have made it their home. They've made its locations, its landscape, and its people the subject of their art, their creative activity.
We have this amazing body of work produced over several generations that does speak to a vivid awareness of modern movements elsewhere, but all worked through this filter of living in the Northwest, of the nature of the Northwest. It starts as early as Harry Wentz in 1910, coming to the Portland Art Museum School and starting to teach in a certain way. It extends all the way up through Jack McLarty, George Johanson, and I think Lucinda Parker, and on.
The legacy is their integrity, how much they loved the work they made, and how they pursued it in spite of the fact that they weren't getting hugely wealthy, and they got such joy out of it. And I'm not saying we should take a vow of poverty. I don't think we should, but if you don't have that reason for working, if you don't have a passion for what you do, forget it. And that's what you're getting. That's what you get from those old timers.
I sort of joke with people that ask if I'm still painting. I say, well, when I was going to art school, they made me sign this piece of paper that said I promised never to quit.
I think, you know, you give your life to it. I mean, that really is what you do. All this stuff about art is what I think about. It's my, I don't think about philosophy. Sometimes I think about art and color and shapes, the things that make up art and painting.
Why do I paint? Because paint is being a human being. And I'm interested in myself as a human being. I try to find out who I am by painting.
Funding for Oregon Experience is provided by the James F. and Marion L. Miller Foundation, the Ann and Bill Swindells Charitable Trust, the Oregon Cultural Trust, and from viewers like you. Thank you.